Good morning, everybody. I'm Dr. Hari Prasad, and this is Dr. Sean Chinchole. Welcome to you, sir. I'll just call out the names. Just tell me whether you're present here. Dr. Atul Kumar?
Not there.
Dr. Meenakshi? Dr. Pankaj? Dr. Manoj Kumar? Dr. Chabi Kedia? Dr. Shraddha Patnaik? Dr. Surabhi? Dr. Anup Kumar? Dr. Ruchir Mehta? Dr. Ankit Agarwal? So if you are uploaded your presentation, then we'll start the session. Dr. Meenakshi? Manoj, you are there, okay, fine. Do you have Dr. Meenakshi? Yeah. So you are the first.
Dr. Anup is there?
Anup is not there, sir.
Atul Kumar is not there. Anup Kumar. All those who are present are comprehensive ophthalmologists, or few are doing cornea, retina. I'm just asking. Okay. The discussion will be more fruitful, that's why.
Please stick to the time. Can you just go back to the preview room and
we'll wait for that, sir. Anybody is having presentation with pen drive or do you have? So we can start. All of you don't have, sir? Okay.
Yeah.
We just. So then you can collect from the mail, sir. They must have that. Please.
Just introduce yourself and.
I'm Dr. Meenakshi Vadwani. I'm currently working as a faculty in Chacha Nehru Bal Chikitsalaya in Geeta Colony in New Delhi. But this is the presentation which I'm being given the opportunity to present by AYOS is a part of my PhD thesis, which was being conducted in RP Center AIIMS, New Delhi, under the guidance of Dr. Professor Praveen Vashisht. And this presentation is a part of my PhD thesis. The topic of the presentation is health seeking behavior among parents of visually impaired children in Delhi. This was a part of the thesis which was on the prevalence of visual impairment conducted in a community in East Delhi. So why childhood visual impairment comes under priority under national program is that though it is responsible for only 3% of overall blindness, but it is kept as one of the major priority under national program, as it's a contributor to under 5 mortality, as well as that a blind child leads to has an effect on economic productivity in the form of disability adjusted life years, and the causes of blindness in children are different from adults, so strategies need to be different. The purpose of this study was to estimate the health seeking behavior among parents of visually impaired children in Delhi. Then why do we need to assess this health-seeking behavior in visually impaired children and among their parents was to establish the need for eye care services, to assess the community perceptions and the utilization patterns, to help in planning and evaluation of programs, and to assess for the attitude for wearing glasses for visual impairment among parents also in the children who were suffering from refractive errors. The sample size was calculated taking the reference sample from the study conducted by Duraiyaraj et al. In South India, which was this was on the visual impairment less than 6/18 in the better eye. On the basis of this, the sample size was calculated to be approximately 20,000. And it was a community-based study. In this, we used the visual acuity and we conducted the visual acuity using two optotypes in the children less than 3 years. It was consisting of children, it involved children from 0 to 15 years. In the children less than 3 years, fixation and following torchlight was the criteria, and among 3 to 15 years, it was a LIA symbol chart and ETDRS optotype used at a distance of 3 meters. And all the children who were found to be either unable in the less than 6/12, unaided in any eye, were referred for a detailed visual acuity examination in a centrally based clinic. And the health-seeking behavior was asked only from the parents of these children. It was we used a semi-structured questionnaire which was already pre-tested, corrected, translated to Hindi, and then back translated to English. The questions were mainly based on assessment of knowledge of eye problems, severity, and what was the attitude of parents towards that. So we had enumerated 40 clusters, and in them, the total 789 children were being referred. Of these 789 children, we found that 97.3% of the parents consulted immediately in the case of trauma. But in the visually impaired children, which was the main target of the study, that is the children with the less than 6/18 in the better eye, only 54% of the children were wearing glasses, even though our clinic was available in their vicinity. And in those and among these visually impaired children, only 20% of the parents were having knowledge about vitamin A and its presence in green leafy vegetables. So with this, I would like to conclude that though the health seeking behavior was good among the children referred, but a lot of knowledge and awareness needs to be created amongst the parents for emphasizing the role of wearing glasses as well as for the role of vitamin A related to ocular health. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you, doctor. What was the reason of mortality? You said there was mortality in cases of child.
No, blindness. I said what that it's a under 5 mortality rate is related to childhood blindness. It's not
related.
Yeah.
Okay, how is it?
Because there is a table or a thing which we use that if the now it has improved, like if there is a mortality rate of 70 to 75, so it leads to around 0.1% of the blindness. So in that way it has been calculated, and this is a visual impairment study. This was not a blindness study because for blindness we need a large sample size of around 1 lakh, which was not possible. So that is why I've told in the previous only that we use this visual impairment for taking the reference population from Duraiyaraj et al. Study, not the blindness.
What was the reason for the parents not seeking treatment, even though you said that your hospital was very near?
No, they were seeking treatment. I said that they were 50% of the children, amongst the children who were diagnosed with refractive error, only 50% of the children were not were wearing glasses. Might be because of the myth or the parents are not interested, and most of the things were that some of the parents reported that they were not even knowing that their child had refractive error.
Did you make out a chart to know what was the reason, exact reason for not seeking the treatment?
Yeah, we had a...
Was it only the lack of awareness? Was anything else?
One was lack of awareness, another was financial problem, and third was that lack of time also, because it was a community, people were belonging to lower socioeconomic strata, they were giving more importance to their work as compared to the child ocular problem.
Now, why I'm asking is, because if you know the reason, you can accordingly manage.
Yeah, we can
so
definitely.
Was there any chart made?
Actually, I'm writing the thesis, so I'll be publishing it soon. So chart is like the data has been analyzed. And from that data only, I am presenting the results.
So you're not going to reveal it now? That's
Pardon?
You're not going to reveal it now?
No, no. I have already told that the major reason was lack of awareness. Second was financial. And third was that they were not giving importance to the correction of glasses, which should be emphasized as a important strategy also in through the government. Or we should, that is why we say that more number of optometrists should be provided at primary health centers so that the children can be benefited, which are lacking.
Do you think any role of teachers?
Yes, sir, definitely.
Because I think because you have not mentioned anything, because all our school going in this, like.
Sir, actually, yes, you're right. But the thing is that mine was a community-based study. And we have already from our center only, there are so many studies which are being conducted for the in the school going children for the role of teachers. The teachers are the, obviously they play a very important role. But here as we as an ophthalmologist were involved, but in many times what happens is that these type of children, they are not even going to school. So that is why it's a community-based study gives a better prevalence and a better picture of the
But in this photo, all kids are from well-doing families. Means I think so, because means it's not, I don't think that is from slum areas
no,
all.
No,
but
sir,
but
this
the thing
picture
is
from Ames only.
Okay.
This is the picture of children who are
okay.
being referred with
yes,
some
yes.
problems.
Right.
That slum area, so that they can be given treatment in the form of cataract surgery, squint surgery, or other best possible treatments.
Yeah, thank you, doctor.
Thank you, sir.
Do we have Dr. Pankaj, Dr. Manoj Kumar? Then we'll have Dr. Chabi.
No, she's there. All had gone.
Yeah. Ratified member.
Thank you. I'm Dr. Chavi Kedia, Comprehensive Fellow at Arvind Eye Hospital, Salem. My topic is microbiological profile of ocular infections observed in a tertiary eye care hospital in Tamil Nadu. Eye is a unique organ which tries to make itself impermeable to external organism. Still, we encounter various pathogenic microorganisms due to imbalances between the host immunity and the virulence of the microorganism. The purpose of this study is to identify the microbiological profile of ocular infections, especially in keratitis and endophthalmitis. Coming to material and methods, 2 years sample were collected from the cases coming to Arvind Eye Hospital, Salem with signs and symptoms of ocular infections. It was then subjected to microbiological analysis. An antibiotic susceptibility test was performed for all the bacterial isolates based on conventional Kirby-Buer disc diffusion method. These are the total number of samples processed in the year 2016 and 2017. The individual culture positive data is mentioned in the coming slides. These are the samples from corneal ulcer cases. In the year 2016, out of the 103 culture positive cases, we had 70 fungal growth, with fusarium being the most common, and 33 total bacterial growth, with pseudomonas being the most common. In the year 2017, again out of 98 total culture positive samples, 70 were fungal, with fusarium being most common, and bacterial were 28 samples, with nocardia being the most common. We also had a microsporidial growth in 2017. This is the antibiotic sensitivity pattern of the gram-positive and gram-negative bacilli. Coming to the samples of endophthalmitis cases, out of the 103 samples that we processed in 2 years, only 34 were culture positive. Out of those, 94% were bacterial and 5.8% were fungal. In bacteria, we had total 13 gram-positive bacteria, most common being coagulase negative staphylococci, and total 19 gram-negative bacteria, with Pseudomonas aeruginosa being the most common. The reason for this was that we had 13 cluster cases of Pseudomonas species from a nearby town, from a general hospital of a nearby town. These were all multi-drug resistant and were only susceptible to polymyxin B. These are the samples from other miscellaneous infections in the year 2016 and 17, in which we encountered mixed growth in both the years. The conclusion of my study is that 70% of the cases of corneal ulcer were due to fungus, with fusarium being the most common in my area. And 30% were bacterial. And in bacterial keratitis, we observed that nocardia outnumbered the Pseudomonas species when compared to the preceding year. Also, bacterial endophthalmitis were more common when compared to the fungal etiology. In conclusion, I would like to say that the data 2 years data collected in my hospital was almost similar to the world literature. And this is the empirical therapy that we follow. This is the empirical therapy for corneal ulcer cases. And this is for endophthalmitis cases. The idea behind the empirical therapy is that most of the organisms will respond to broad spectrum antibiotics. Thank you.
Thank you, doctor. What was the reason for such a low culture positivity? You said it's 33,
sir. 33,
yeah.
Sir, because in endophthalmitis cases, the sample that we take is generally from the periphery, and we can yield good positivity only if we get the sample from the core. And so the inoculum was very less, and that's why positivity came down.
Was that the only reason, or you could find out some other reasons? Sample size, contamination during the processing, something like that. So you are taking the corneal samples also?
Yes, sir,
isn't
for
it?
Keratitis and for endophthalmitis both.
So you said that one of the reasons is from the vitreous tap in
yes
endophthalmitis.
Sir. Yes, sir. And in
if you consider corneal cases also, the culture positivity is really less. You have seen so many number of cases.
Yes, sir. In corneal, first year, out of 196, we had 103 culture positive. And
okay,
sometimes, sir, when the patients come with corneal infections, they would have already...
So the corneal positivity is much more in corneal scrapes,
yes,
than
sir
in vitreous
yes
tap. So I want to know what was the reason. That's the thing. Because... as I told, one reason can be the sample size itself.
Yes, sir.
Another is contamination during the processing. So did you find out? No, okay. Fine. So what was the treatment protocol for nocardia? Because nocardia is known to be resistant to medical management.
Sir, for endophthalmitis cases, generally for intravitreal we use vancomycin with ceftazidin, but as it is resistant, so we go with amikacin with okay. or without steroids.
So I think in your setup, I think the number of cases is done SICS or the FACO?
Sir, mostly SICS by the trainees, FACOs will be done by.
So nocardia endophthalmitis,
this is a tertiary care.
Nocardia endophthalmitis, so is common?
Sir, in my study, most of the cases that we got were referred from other hospital. In our
okay,
hospital,
SICS or FACO? How is it?
So the cluster cases that we got was all SICS, sir.
SICS.
Yes, sir.
So during SICS, so usually the pattern is the section infiltrates with the posterior involvement. That's how it is.
Yes, sir.
Isn't it?
Yes, sir.
So how do you manage such cases? How did you manage that? So managing a section infiltrate is also very difficult. Mm. The section melts there.
Yes, sir.
Was that involved in the study, particular study?
No.
No. Okay. Fine. Thank you, doctor.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah.
Very good afternoon. I am Dr. Shraddha Patnaik from SCB Medical College, Cuttack, Odisha, second year postgraduate student. Today I am here to present on the topic oculovasculopathy in cirrhosis, a study of choroidal thickness, RNFL, and retinopathy features. Cirrhosis is primarily a disease of liver having multiple systemic implications like encephalopathy, ascites, etc. And ocular effects of cirrhosis is not a well-studied feature. Choroid is a highly vascular structure and it is important for the functioning of retina. Newer imaging techniques like SDOCT and EDI help in understanding the pathologic process. The aim of my study was to study the ocular involvement in patients of cirrhosis, including the retinal changes and choroidal thickness measurement with EDI-OCT. In this study, 97 patients with cirrhosis admitted to the gastroenterology department of SCB Medical College, Cuttack were studied. The time period of study was August 2017 to April 2018. The tests performed were visual acuity, fundoscopy, OCT measurement of the choroidal thickness and peripapillary RNFL. This was a prospective observational study in which 194 eyes of cirrhosis patients were studied for retinopathy and 34 patients were subjected to EDI-OCT as ambulation of patients with decompensated cirrhosis was difficult. OCT findings were compared with 24 age and sex matched healthy individuals. The modified Child-Pugh criteria was used to classify the patient and thus I had 37 patients in class A, 45 patients in class B and 15 patients in class C. The subfoveal choroidal thickness was measured vertically from the outer border of the RP to the choroidal scleral interface. Coming to the results, among the retinopathy features, 40% of the patients presented with hemorrhage and exudates and 20% patients presented with temporal pallor. The other features that were commonly seen was choroidal atrophy, Drusen and CSR, and normal fundus was seen in 11% of the cases. Coming to the prevalence of retinopathy features with severity of cirrhosis as per the modified Child-Pugh criteria, in class A, about 21% of the patients had retinopathy. In class B, 6% of the patients had retinopathy, and in class C, 13% of the patients had retinopathy features. These are the fundus photographs of two patients with Child-Pugh class B, showing hemorrhages and hard exudates. Choroidal thickness measurement in healthy participants and cirrhosis were compared. The mean value was compared, and we can clearly see that in controls, in comparison to the controls in cirrhosis patient is significantly lower. The mean nasal and the mean temporal RNFL was found to be lower, and the mean subfoveal choroidal thickness was also found to be lower. Thus, choroidal, as it supplies the layer of the outer blood to the outer layer of the retina, it may play a key role in pathophysiologic mechanism, and can be RNFL thickness thinning may be associated with the microvascular effects of cirrhosis. And this was a significant, and this decrease was significant, as the p-value is less than 0.001. Retinal hemorrhages were the commonest feature which was found. This study proves that portal hypertension has significant effects on retina and choroid. The abnormal volume or flow in choroid can cause the photoreceptor and RPE dysfunction. Coagulation impairment results in retinal hemorrhages, and that might be why we had 40% of the cases with retinal hemorrhages. Thus, ocular manifestations should be looked for these patients to avoid subsequent ocular morbidity. And these are some of the cases that I see, that I could see the studies. World Journal of Gastroenterology, a study was done in 2005. It also found hemorrhages and exudates in 31.8% of the patients. And another study which was done in Rio de Janeiro, here in 2015, they also found significant decrease in peripapillary retinal nerve fiber layer and choroidal thickness in all cirrhosis patients. Thank you.
Thank you, doctor. So how is your study clinically relevant?
So we can look for such features if the like cirrhosis patients, and we never look for retinopathy features in such patients. But they had, I mean, most of the patients that I saw, they had complaints. Because it is such a serious disorder, we only look for the systemic features, but to overlook the eyes. So this is one thing that we can
so
see.
Do you want
and
to treat them?
So treatment will be well controlled portal hypertension only. Like
that's it.
If the PT-INR will be controlled, the features will come down.
So just for prognosis purpose?
Yes,
you mean.
Sir, prognosis.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Dr. Surabhi? So we are having Dr. Krishna Prasad Kudlu on stage as a judge. Welcome you, sir. Yeah, start.
Good morning, everybody. I'm Dr. Surabhi Benival, final year post-graduation student from KLE's Jawaharlal Nehru Medical College, Karnataka. The title of my study is Ocular Manifestations in Psoriasis, a one-year cross-sectional study. Psoriasis is a chronic disease, genetics, environment, and the immune system being the influencing factors. It has a prevalence rate of 1 to 3% with various extracutaneous manifestations. 10% of these patients develop ocular manifestations. Bilateral involvement is common, and these complications occur much later after the skin involvement and usually during disease exacerbations. The ocular manifestations of psoriasis are subtle. They can be overlooked without a dedicated ocular examination. Materials and methods. A cross-sectional observational study was conducted over a period of 1 year. Patients more than 18 years of age, diagnosed to have psoriasis, attended the dermatology and ophthalmology outpatient department and who consented for the study were included. Patient particulars like age, sex, address, and occupational details were taken. Patients were evaluated for type of psoriasis, the severity based on the PSI score, duration of disease, site of psoriatic lesion, extent of skin involvement, and the detailed treatment history was taken. Ocular examination included visual acuity using Snellen's chart, extraocular movements, anterior segment examination using slit lamp, Schirmer's 1 test, TBUT test, applanation tonometry for the measurement of intraocular pressure, posterior segment examination using a 90D lens, and indirect ophthalmoscopy if needed. Among the 75 cases of psoriasis, 70.67% had ocular manifestations, which was in congruence with the study done by Chandran et al. And Erbakci et al., who found the prevalence to be 67% and 65% respectively. The mean age of patient in the study was 46.8 plus or minus 11.65 years, ranging from 18 to 68 years, and majority of the patients in the study were in the age group between 41 to 60 years. Out of the 75 patients, 57 were male and 18 were female, and 15 out of the 18 females, that is 83% of the females, had ocular manifestations, and 67% of males had ocular manifestations. Duration of disease in my study was in the study population was 5.4 plus or minus 4.4 years, and majority of the patients had disease duration of less than 5 years. And it was proved that there is no statistical significance between the duration of the disease and ocular manifestation of psoriasis. Based on the type of psoriasis, the plaque kind of lesion had maximum number of patients, and they had the maximum number of ocular manifestations. And about 50% of the patients had a PASI score less than 5, 72% patients had a score between 5 to 10, and 74% patients had a score more than 10, and they were the patients who showed the maximum ocular manifestations. A total of 55 patients were on systemic treatment, and of those, a maximum were on methotrexate, and 43 of these patients had ocular manifestation. Out of the 75 patients, 53 patients had ocular manifestations, of which cataract had a prevalence of 33%, followed by dry eye, that is 28%, 17% of the patients had blepharitis, conjunctivitis was seen in 9% of patients, uveitis in 8, and chalazion was seen in 3% of cases, and hardiolum in 1%. One patient was diagnosed with presenile cataract, who was between the age of 21 to 40 years, and he had early posterior subcapsular cataract in both the eyes. Between the age group of 41 to 60 years, 17 patients had cataract, either of the nuclear type, nuclear sclerosis type, or posterior subcapsular type. A Schirmer test value was low in 21 psoriasis patients, and 12 psoriasis patients had low tear film breakup time. In some patients with a PASI score of more than 10, it was recorded as low as 4 mm and 5 mm in the right and left eye respectively. However, there was no statistical significance difference in the Schirmer's value between the psoriasis activity in the patients either less than or more than 10 by either the unpaired test nor were the tear film breakup time. 28 of the 75 psoriasis patients had dry eye disease, who had Schirmer's less than 10 mm and TBUT less than 10 seconds, with the prevalence being higher among the patients with high PASI score, that is more than 10. Lima et al. In their study have found abnormal Schirmer's test in 50% of psoriasis patients, along with 67% abnormality in the tear film breakup time. Kilik et al. Noted Schirmer test and tear film breakup time values to be statistically lower in the patient group than those in the control group. In our study, the prevalence rate was 37.3%, and this may be underestimated because of the rigid diagnostic criteria that I'd used, that is Schirmer's less than 10 and TBUT less than more than 10 seconds. In addition, there is a poor relationship between the signs and symptoms of dry eye. Therefore, there could be more number of cases of dry eyes which have gone unnoticed. Bagasi et al. Showed 65% prevalence of blepharitis in psoriasis patients, whereas in our study it was found to be only 17% of the cases. Anterior seborrheic blepharitis was most commonly seen, and it was most common in patients with the plaque kind of psoriasis, followed by erythematic psoriasis. Conjunctival manifestations were seen in 7 patients, which had diffuse kind of conjunctival injection. Corneal involvement was seen in none of the patients. 6 patients had uveitis, who were diagnosed with anterior uveitis. PASI score in these patients was more than 10, and all the cases had bilateral manifestation and had associated psoriatic arthritis. Few studies relate uveitis with psoriatic arthropathy, while some studies have found it as an independent entity. None of the patients had increased IOP nor increased cup-to-disc ratio. The mean IOP was 15 mm of HG, and the highest IOP recorded was 19 and 18 mm of HG in the right and left eye respectively. And the cup-to-disc ratio was between 0.3 to 0.6, and no patient was diagnosed to have glaucoma. And no significant fundal changes were seen in the patients. To conclude, there are no established criteria for screening of ophthalmic complications in patients with psoriasis till date. Given the serious nature of the untreated disease, the dermatologist should have a high index of suspicion of ocular findings in these patients. Likewise, ophthalmologists should also ask for history of psoriasis when evaluating ocular symptoms. All patients with psoriasis must undergo detailed ocular examination, considering the possibility that involvement of the eye may progress with no symptoms and may be independent of factors such as gender, the PASI score, duration of disease, and the nail and joint involvement. Further studies are needed to explain the etiopathogenesis of ocular findings in patients with psoriasis. Thank you.
Thank you, doctor. How your management change in a patient with ocular manifestation and with a patient without ocular manifestation?
So basically the management was symptomatic based, and in case of cataract patients, surgery was performed. But the thing was, the main aim of the study was just to identify these patients earlier. The management remained more or less the same, sir.
But we
call them a regular follow-up to just see that do they respond faster or like the regular patients.
Okay, you mean to say there is no change in the overall management of psoriasis with a patient with the ocular manifestation?
Not the psoriasis management. Sir, I was talking about the ophthal management, sir.
Yeah.
Yes, sir.
Ocular manifestation in psoriasis, right?
Yes, yes, sir.
So what I'm asking is there any change in the management of psoriasis in a case of
psoriasis,
ocular,
yes,
manifestation?
Because we use steroids.
As compared with a patient with no ocular manifestation.
So these patients, then we can tell the dermatologist that steroid dosing then has to be monitored, plus the patients who are on methotrexate. If they develop symptoms, then an alternative treatment has to be sorted out for these patients.
Okay, from ophthal side, there is no change in the management. That's what you meant to say.
Yes, sir.
Okay, thank you, doctor.
Thank you, sir.
Yes, sir.
Good morning all. Reduce the recurrence by using heme coagulase and tucking in for pterygium surgery. All of us are doing pterygium surgery, and lot of time whatever method we are going for, whether it is a graft, whether it is a Bayer sclera or using fibrin glue, most of the time there is a recurrence. No financial disclosure. To compare the recurrence rate after a simple sutureless, glueless pterygium surgery with the use of topical heme coagulase and tucking in for the conjunctival autograft surgery. It was done in Riva. Study design was prospective interventional. 64 patients underwent primary pterygium surgery of any gender and age and were subjected to surgery were divided into two groups. A, in which a simple sutureless, glueless and conjunctival autograft was done. And group B, 32 eyes, we used a topical heme coagulase and tucking in for the conjunctival autograft. All the patients with the true primary pterygium were included and excluded those who had a corneal morbidity, those who were on anticoagulant therapy, patients suffering from coagulation factor deficiencies, any history of previous ocular surgery or any ocular disease or history of any previous ocular trauma. In both the cases, it was the male preponderance of the pterygium, and most of them were the farmers doing outdoor activities. Amongst the age, maximum number of pterygium patients were from 36 to 50 years of the age group, and the surgical success rate was recurrence of pterygium after first year of the postoperative period was more in group A compared to the group B. It was 12.5% in group A and it was 6.5% in group B. In our study, the mean age in group 1 was 51.74 and group B it was 45.74, range from 18 to 80 years. The male predominance in both the groups, farmers were more, In the study done by Pandey et al., the males were predominant, having 75.1% males and female 24. Rupali Venu Kumar had studied the 20 eyes, and their study revealed the mean age of the patient 52.4 years. The results were analyzed. Group A, 4 recurrence and 1 patient lost the graft, 3.12%, and group B had only 2 case showed the recurrence, in which we used a topical hemocoagulase. So this is a very simple technique for the pterygium surgery, which may prevent the potential adverse reactions encountered with the use of any foreign material. Hence the coagulase, which is autologous in situ blood coagulum with the use of topical hemocoagulase and tucking in for the conjunctival autograft, is a better option to reduce the recurrence. Thank you.
Sir, can you please explain the surgical technique again?
Yes. In the surgical technique, when we are removing, normally in the Bayer sclera, what we are doing is removing the head, body and part 11 up to 11 millimeter, and we are putting it simply. But in topical hemocoagulase, what we are doing is, when we are cutting it, blood is oozing out. So from the sides, we are putting a swab and removing the blood, but in that part, we'll wait for 5 to 6 minutes so as to make a coagulum. And we'll put this graft over that coagulum, and we tuck in the parts over the body inside the cut bare area. So there are two things: that tucking will make him to be in place, and that coagulum acts as a natural fibrin of his own body. So there is no foreign body reaction or nothing. So the results are better.
So what is the waiting time, sir? Do you wait?
5 to 6 minutes. You
Five
have to wait
minutes.
For.
Okay.
Once it starts oozing from the sides, you go on removing the extra blood, but in the bare area where you want to put the graft, let the coagulum be clotted, and that is the area when you over that clot you put the graft.
So you wait up till 6
yes
to 10
you
minutes.
Have to wait
okay.
for. But only drawback is, in one case we had a loss. Next day when we opened, there was no graft at all. So that is the one complication. Otherwise it is very good. Recurrence rate was also less, and patient's comfort was the most important, that because there is no suture, no any other material is used. Because I am from Rewa, most of the time other medical or surgical things you can get from the medical shops, but for the ophthalmic things nothing is available, you have to ask for. So fibrin glue is even not available, so this is the method where you don't need anything else to add on.
So you have a preference for the site for conjunctival graft?
No, that is superior nasal we are taking.
So you take it from superior nasal?
Yeah.
Okay, sir.
Do you find sometimes when you have cut the superior nasal, there also you will get some
blood is coming? That oozing is not important for us, because we don't want
but
that.
Do you cauterize that one?
Like no. We are not doing. We are simply putting a swab to remove that clot so that there is
no
extra.
No, I'm asking the graft which you have cut. Yeah, upper
place. No. We are not. No cauterization.
Okay.
Thank you, sir.
Anoop, yeah.
Good afternoon, colleagues. I shall be presenting a rare case of Gordon-Holm syndrome, which we almost missed. The idea is to increase awareness of this rare disorder. A 33-year-old female came to us with complaints of progressive painless diminution of vision both eyes. The best corrected visual acuity was 660. Examination showed horizontal nystagmus and alternating exotropia of 18 prism diopters. Pupillary reaction were brisk with quiet anterior chamber and normal intraocular pressure. Now, fundus showed a pigmenty retinopathy affecting the posterior poles and the mid-peripheral regions with beaten bronze reflex. There was no history of any night blindness. There was no history of any previous surgery in the eye or any vernacular treatment. but she gave history of consulting gynecologist and physician for systemic complaints. She also complained of difficulty in walking. Family history did not reveal any similar illness in the siblings. General examination showed short stature, poor tandem walk, and a slurred speech. A provisional diagnosis of Friedreich's ataxia was made and the patient was referred for neurological opinion. The MRI was conducted by the neurologist and we found that there was a small anterior pituitary with diffuse cerebellar atrophy. Records revealed a hyperplastic uterus and ovary with primary amenorrhea and decreased gonadotropin levels. Diagnosis was revised to Gordon-Holm syndrome in consultation with neurologist and vitamin D3, C and E with gait training were started. Counseling was done for diminution of vision along with low vision aid. Now, Gordon-Holm syndrome is an autosomal recessive adult onset neurodegenerative disorder characterized by ataxia, hypo or hypergonadotropic hypogonadism, psychomotor retardation and dementia. Ocular features reported are retinopathy, nystagmus and ophthalmoplegia. Mutation in RNF216 gene has been described as the possible etiology, although cases do occur without this mutation, and these cases without the mutation do not develop dementia. Pathophysiology is also not absolutely clear, and it has heterogeneous, but primary endocrinopathy is of pituitary origin. Now, Gordon-Holm syndrome is an entity with different genotypes leading to varied phenotypic manifestations. And very few authors have described this case, and Holmes was the first to describe association of ataxia and hypogonadism in 1907. Then we can skip this. The present case basically illustrates Gordon-Holm syndrome associated with pigmented retinopathy. Although we don't have much to offer in terms of management, but with advancing techniques, we can have gene therapy in years to come as a possible treatment or even stem cell therapy. So as of now, we can only give a supportive treatment. To conclude, for ophthalmologists, systemic evaluation is a must in presence of pigmented retinopathy to avoid wrong diagnosis. On the other hand, neurologists, endocrinologists, and gynecologists should also be sensitized for possible ocular abnormalities in patients with ataxia or hypogonadism. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. So, how common the condition is?
It's very rare. Only 6 or 7 case reports are there in the literature. Okay. That's it.
So, how did you suspect that it might be a case of?
See, as we started inquiring about the possibilities of other features, see, she gave a history of diminution of vision for past 5 years, and that was progressive. When we saw the fundus, the picture is not clear. It is not supporting any particular diagnosis. We thought of atypical retinitis pigmentosa, so we inquired about night blindness, which was categorically absent. Even the other family members also told that she is able to walk around in the similar condition at dusk as the other family members. So that thing was ruled out. Now, as we inquired about other features, she said she had difficulty in walking. And plus she had a slurred. Slurring of speech was also progressive over the years. So then we referred the case to neurological opinion. And there how he suggested that probably it is a case of Gordon-Holm syndrome. Although for an absolute diagnosis, we need a genetic mapping.
So the diagnosis was made clinically?
Yes, that was a clinical, plus the MRI findings.
Okay.
Yes.
So basically it was a neurologist diagnosis?
It's a kind of a joint effort.
Okay, sir.
Thank you.
Dr. Ruchir? No. Dr. Ankit?
Afternoon. The topic of my poster podium presentation is it is a case of spontaneous bilateral subluxation of PCIOL after 10 years due to pseudoexposition syndrome. So this foliation is an age-related microfibrillopathy seen mostly in patients above 50 years of age. In this, the deposition of fibrillary residue from the lens and iris pigment epitheliums occurs on the lens capsule, ciliary body, zonules, corneal endothelium, and iris. It can cause open-angle glaucoma, that is pseudo-exploitative glaucoma, in 50% of cases due to deposition of fibrillary material on the trabecular meshwork, thereby blocking the aqueous outflow. Coming to the case report, 60-year-old male patient who came with complaints of uniocular diplopia in both eyes, that is left eye more than right eye, since last 6 months. He had no history of head trauma or ocular trauma, and he gave history of both eyes cataract surgery 10 years back without any history of diabetes mellitus or hypertension. On anterior segment examination, we could see that white flaky deposits were present on the pupillary margin and the pupil was sluggishly reactive. While the lens was inferiorly subluxated in both the eyes, and on dilatation, we could see that 2/3 of the PCIOL optic was present in the pupillary area in right eye, and only 1/3 was present in the left eye. The IOP was normal in both the eyes by non-contact tonometer. Here is the anterior segment photograph. We can see that while the pupil is constricted in the right eye, the optic is present in completely covering the pupillary axis. But when dilated, we can see the inferomedial subluxation is present. While in the left eye, when the pupil is constricted, it's almost as aphakia. While when the pupil is dilated, we can see that inferior subluxation of PCIOL is present. Now, management of this condition was, we did the A scan of left eye after dilating using pseudophakic mode. And the subluxated intraocular lens was explanted along with the capsular bag, that is ICCE, was done. An anterior vitrectomy was performed. An ACIOL was carefully placed. Postoperatively, in the left eye, unaided vision was 618. While with pinhole, the vision came to 612, and patient stopped complaining of any diplopia in the left eye. Discussion. Pseudoexploration syndrome causes weakening of zonules, which leads to subluxation of crystalline lens as well as the PCIOL. The condition may be present unilaterally or bilaterally, but if present bilaterally, it is usually asymmetrical. The etiology is unknown, but it is a generalized disorder involving abnormal production of extracellular matrix in the basement membrane and has been associated with myocardial infarction, cerebrovascular infarctions, and systemic hypertension. It can cause zonular weakness due to deposition of pseudoexploitative material on the zonular fiber and ciliary processes, resulting in proteolytic disintegration of zonules that leads to spontaneous fragmentation. And poor pupillary dilatation is due to infiltration of iris stroma with excessive extracellular matrix, causing mechanical obstruction to mydriasis. The genetic link has been found with LOX1 gene, and which encodes the cross-linking of collagen and elastin in the extracellular matrix. There is some studies which have shown a high link between serum homocystinuria and pseudoexfoliation. Coming to the conclusion of my study, it is important for a cataract surgeon to consider the possibility of subluxation of PCIOL in pseudoexfoliation syndrome patient, not only during cataract surgeries, that is perioperative, but also in the following years, as the weakening of zonules is a continuous process, and zonular break can be precipitated by any trivial or no trauma in further years.
Thank you, doctor. So what were the factors leading to progressive subluxation after cataract surgery?
So pseudoexfoliation was must have been present when the patient was operated. Patient is aged patient. So previously when he was operated also, pseudoexfoliation must have been present. So at that, a patient gives that history that his vision was perfect for 9 years and a half years after surgery. So suddenly when he's starting losing diplopia, that means that the pseudoexfoliation has progressed to such an extent that zonular weakness continuing occur. Maybe he had some trivial trauma, he's not remembering some fall from bed or any bump on the head. And thus a zonular dehiscence occurs in the superior area, which has led to inferior subluxation of the lens.
So how did you manage the case?
Sir, we did PCIOL along with the capsular bag explantation of the lens, and anterior vitrectomy was performed, and ACIOL was put. Patient was not able to afford iris law or SFIOL surgery. So we did the ACIOL implantation, and it was patient was quite good, happy with the postoperative result. He got 618 vision, improving to 612 with pinhole. But we lost the case after the patient did not come after for the other eye surgery, and we lost the case to follow after that, sir.
But doesn't ACIOL in a case of pseudoexfoliation, which can have endothelial related problems,
There is a possibility, sir, because a pseudoexfoliative material, when it will deposit on the endothelium, it already is, the endothelium is damaged, and ACIOL again, then endothelial dysfunction can occur. But again, sir, affordability was an issue, and a patient was quite old, sir. We thought that a useful vision for next 5 to 10 years is what is required for this patient.
Okay, it's a very harsh assessment. Okay, thank you, doctor.
Yes.
Dr. Ruchir, Dr. Manoj Kumar,
good morning everyone. My topic is a study of effect of preventive measure on quality of life in patient with computer vision syndrome. Introduction. In this present era, excessive computer usage led to an increase in the number of patients complaining about ocular and non-ocular symptoms, which are being grouped together as computer vision syndrome. American Optometric Association has defined computer vision syndrome as a complex of eye and vision associated problem mainly related to activities which stresses and the near vision and which are experienced in relation or during the use of computer. Numerous factors accounting for computer vision syndrome are duration of usage, poor lighting, screen brightness, environmental factors, vision problems, and improper workstation setup. The symptoms of computer vision syndrome are classified into four major categories: the stenopic symptoms, ocular surface related symptom, visual symptoms, and the extraocular symptom. The aim of present study was to assess the changes in quality of life in patients with computer vision syndrome after taking preventive measures only. Materials and method. Study design is prospective intervention study. Sample size of total 120 patients was included in this study. Inclusion criteria is subject working on computer for at least 6 months and not using any kind of eye drops and ready to give informed consent for the study. While exclusion criteria are subjects older than 40 years are excluded because of age-induced vision problems of presbyopia, contact lens users, corneal opacities, known case of dry eye disease and ocular motility disorders, subject using eye drops. Sampling method is detailed history was noted and subject were requested to fill the questionnaire provided to them. This is the questionnaire along with this. A detailed examination of eyes was done. A similar questionnaire was requested to fill after 1 month of follow-up for taking preventive measures and detailed examination was repeated. Study site and duration. The duration of study was conducted over a span of 6 months on a sample of population attending ophthalmic clinic at VPIMS, Lucknow. Data analysis, statistical package for social sciences, SPSS 21 is used for the data analysis. Results and observations. Mean plus minus standard deviation of age of subjects was 27.08 plus minus 5.06 years. A higher proportion of cases were aged between 21 to 30 years of age. Males are more commonly affected. The male-female ratio in the patients are found to be 54.2:45.8%. Excess usage of computer was seen among the patients. Almost 33.3% cases were spending more than 8 hours per day on computer. Most of the cases were spending 2 to 4 stretch hours per day on the computer. And most of the cases were using computer more than 4 years of duration, 43.3%. The most most disturbing symptom of CVS cases were headache, 48.3%, followed by pain behind the eyes, 21.7%, and tired eyes, 23.3%. Emetropic refractive status was found in 66.7% cases, while 30.8% were myopic. 55.8% cases were unaware about the computer vision syndrome. While assessing the quality of life score at various follow-ups, we found improvement only on the basis of the improving in the work atmosphere, while CVS score is improved from 21.42 to 20.03. So discussion, after assessing the astenopic symptom in computer vision syndrome, patient in the treatment duration, it was found that problems of pain behind eye, tired eye, and redness in eye was significantly reduced after second or third follow-ups. The problems of watery eye, dry eye, and itchy eye were significantly reduced after second and third follow-ups. The most common preventive measures against the CVS was taking break during the use of computer, while only 12.5% and 10.8% were using massage of eye or use of eye drops respectively. Conclusion, after assessing the quality of life on the basis of QOL score, it was found that average QOL score was reduced from 3.24 to 2.53 at last follow-up, which is highly significant. So the study showed an overall improvement with respect to the reduction in CVS problem and quality of life among the 120 cases after the completion of treatment procedure. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you, doctor. So what was the duration of the break that you suggested?
Sir, at least 5 to 10 minutes after 2 hours.
For every 2 hours?
For every 2 hours. For every 2 hours of stretch of the work.
Okay. What were the other suggestions that you gave?
So workstation problem, workstation management, like light should be on the left or above the at the ceiling, and there is the ample space in the, for the leg space, and computer should be at the level of eye, so that eye does not open wide.
At the level or just below the eye level?
So just upper line is just at the level of eye.
Okay, I'm asking the level of the computer screen.
So computer is below the level of eye.
Yes, not exactly at the level
so
of
highest
the eye.
Line is at the level of eye.
Okay, that's because you don't want the exposure to be.
Yes, sir.
Okay, fine. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Do we have Dr. Atul? Dr. Ruchir? No. Okay. So we'll end the session. We thank Dr. Sean Chinchole. So we'll start next session.